Okay. Welcome everybody. First of all, welcome to the photographers. This is an exhibition, it's a vernissage actually, so we have a very, very great panel here tonight, also about architectural photography, but welcome to the photographers, to the artists who are showing the eight physical exhibition. First, welcome also to some of the architects of the projects which are shown tonight. Some authors are here who've been writing for the newest RTZ Swiss Performance 2018, and of course to all the guests and to the experts here on the podium, experts about photography or artists, photo artists themselves. Let me at the beginning quickly say some brief words to this project, what RTZ is dealing with photography and how this exhibition came into place. It's actually something, we have a crisis in our editor's office when we are dealing with photos actually these days, because the photos we are offered from the mostly from the architects, they're fantastic, they're of high quality. You see the project very clear, it's very documentary, and you can get of almost every project a perfect set of photos, but they're kind of all of the same. And we realized the reason is that today most of the interesting offices, they have a homepage. So they kind of assign photographers to do these photos, and they give the directions how they show them. So who asks, actually say, who calls the piper, decides the tune. So we wondered if that actually has to be like this, and as we do like a best of Swiss architecture, and we're here with the Swiss performance, we wondered maybe we can kind of break out of this kind of set which kind of established over the last years. So like 3 years ago, we wondered, can we do an experiment and try to give photographers a carte blanche so that they're not actually kind of fulfilling the assignment of the architects who give them the assignments, but try to give them action, to free them from all these constraints and ask them to come up with an idea themselves what architecture and photography could be. So this was like a great risk because we didn't know what would happen. And we gave this kind of first carte blanche to a class of the certification school here for Farbe in the class of Gunnar Remann, who is also here tonight. And we showed some of the images surrounding the introduction text in the stream. And the second year we did like the same experiments with Tobias Martin, who was teaching photography at ETH Zurich with architecture students. And so you can see the outcome of these 2 years, like in the previous two architects editions of Swiss Performance. This year we actually are very happy that Poelitzia kind of stepped in this project and agreed to support us by giving grants to 8 young professional photographers who were then chosen in a kind of small competition. And the editors decided about the 8 projects we think were the most interesting ones, but they gave a carte blanche to these young professionals, asking them to photograph them whatever way they think fits, which is interesting for within architectural discourse. So I would just read the name of these 3 photographers and tell them which city they work and live and the projects they've been photographing for this issue. So first, Robert Bervini from Chiasso. He photographed the Oregon Theatre Tower in Julia Pass by Giovanni Nezza Valdovino. It's a very rare building here on the left. Then we have Maya Bentley from Zurich. She was photographing the project for Manuel Herz in Villa, it's a multi-family house, Ballet Mechanique in Zurich. It stands next to a villa or over there. We have Aruna Canevaschini from Fribourg. That's the work here in the front. These are images from a residential house in Zurich Medicom, but they were Armula and Lamprecht. We have images from Valentin Forain from the Lochlen. He was taking photos from a residential block in Winterthur. That's the one here opposite of the bar. We have images from Quentin Lacombe from Lausanne from a transformation of a residential house in Brook. It's a very green one at the end of Quintest next to me. We have images from Clément Lamblay. He was doing
pictures for Matilda Olin from Lausanne. She was taking pictures from the Olinberg estate from BDE Architectures over there. And we have images from Manon Wertenberg, Chevrolet, and she was taking pictures of the new Swiss Re headquarters in Zurich. You see them in the front, and you see three of her images kind of glued on the glass of the entrance. So you have to go outside later and to see all of her images. So thanks again to Paul Elvizia, who was generously supporting this project. Also thanks to the Architectural Forum Zurich that we are getting the guest here tonight. Christoph Böhm, the president, is also on our podium tonight. Thanks for hosting us. Thanks to the IKEA Foundation, they will support the Becha Kucha, which will be here next week. It's like we call it Swiss Life Performance. There will be more projects shown which actually did not make it into the magazine, but we consider them also very interesting. So come back next Thursday. And we also, I also want to say thanks to the architects and team who in this case did a lot of effort on top of the editorial work to get this exhibition done. So now I will give the microphone to Pauline Nicol from Paul Elvizia. She will also address the new with some words about this project.
Thank you. I think I stand up. So good evening, everybody. So welcome here. I have to say that I'm quite impressed to stand here tonight. Photographers have always the chance to really work in an experimental and creative way. And we were very pleased of it. It was for a project in the mode photography, a fashion photography, for the daily the weekly press, and like today in the architecture magazines. And for the project of today, as you said to it, I have to say, went further than our expectation, because the idea was again to start with this collaboration with the magazine to give a grant to young photographers that were selected from a short list of nominees that we have at Pro Helvetia. And the idea was, to, as you said, it was really to give them a carte blanche, which was very nice for them to really give them the chance to give, in a way, their own interpretation of brand new buildings made by famous and important architecture offices. And I think here we are really seeing how it was really the idea not to put them or to ask them to fit into a very specific category of architecture photography, but really to test the limits of the architecture photography. And I think that it's the best place to do it. It's in an architecture magazine, I would say. And now as I said, the project extended, because now the project goes further, and there is not only the idea to experience this through the pages of the magazines, but also within the spaces of the architecture forum. I think it's really bring a new dimension to the projects themselves. I think it's really nice to compare the two, the series in the magazines and now in the exhibition. And also, I think that it's also a great opportunity that, it gives also the opportunity for tonight to have this panel discussion. Thank you.
Let me introduce our five guests here on the panel tonight. I start with Christoph Böble. As I said, he's the president of the forum, which is our host tonight. He did an apprenticeship to be a photographer, he told me. I should strike that out. So he's like, and after that he studied art history, German studies, visual communications. He worked as an architecture historian and theoretician. He teached at several universities, was publishing manager for different publishing houses, for example, Kingsley and Betty, he wrote many books, and he's board member of the ZAZ, Zurich's new architecture center, which will soon be come to life at the Bell Cave.
Welcome, Christoph.
Then we have Marianne Müller, based artist who works with photography, video, installation, and books. She observes generic everyday built environments and recontextualizes them in her work, often in reaction to the specific site of the exhibition. You will see something about of that later. Marianne is a professor at the Zurich University of Art. She published numerous publications and was published in numerous publications. And she did, for example, a book called The Architectural Praxis of Johnston Marbury. Then Stefano Stoll. He studied history and arts and economics at the AGC Lausanne. He is co-founder of the Journée Photographique de Bienne. He is director and curator of the internationally known festival Image in Vevey, a visual artist, arts biennale focusing on outdoor monumental photography and site-specific installations. He runs also the Image Vevey International Photography Award, one of Europe's oldest photography creation support grants. Ben, welcome. Ben next to me, I already introduced him very quickly. Quentin Lacombe is one of the eight artists who delivered the kind of made these contributions to Alexis's new Swiss performance. He studied architecture at the École Nationale Supérieure de Paris in La Villette. Then he did a bachelor in photography at ECAL. He is living and working in Lausanne, and he is an assistant for photography at the Department for Photography at the ECAL, and also he is a freelance photographer. So welcome, Quentin. And then, last but not least, Eva Bühlmann. He studied graphic design at the Graphisches Museum Zwolle. Now I'm getting totally confused with naming Dutch institutions in English, I'm sorry. The Willem de Koning Academy in Rotterdam, and visual communications at the St. Joost Academy in Breda. He was teaching and researching at Zetatica in Zurich, and at the Hochschule für Gestaltung und Kunst in Basel, also at the University of Technology in Sydney. Right, for several years he teaches visual communications and studies called camera arts at the Hochschule in CERN, for design and kunst, and he's currently doing a PhD in research at Hafen University in Hamburg. So welcome the five of you. I'm looking forward to a discussion. Our question today is the potential of what architecture photography could be, and you can already tell that this podium is totally biased because we did not invite any of these professional photographers to do these thousands of nice photographs we are kind of facing in every day in the blogs and the magazines, but we invited guests who we think have an idea out of the box, maybe what else architecture photography could be or should be in future. So I want to give the first question to Christoph. Because he was the chief editor of Architase for many years. He shaped the magazine, the content, of course, and also the visual appearance of the magazine. And he also established the Swiss Performance. So now we have like the 18th volume. I think you came up with the idea around the turn of the century to have this best of Swiss architecture, which we kind of inherited from you. And I would like to ask you now, when you see this exhibition, that we turn it into an experiment field for architecture photography, what are your thoughts when you look at these images here today?
I invented this title, Swiss Performance, in order to, against the Werkbauen Wohnen, they dated all the new architecture with the architect, so there was nothing left for Architase. So I thought, now we did conferences, we have to do something. And we invented this magazine, and all my colleagues were against it, because Architase always were magazines with one theme, and this performance is complete difference. So, but it was the most successful magazine over the whole years. I think it's nearly the same today. So, and The second reason was that we wanted to work more together with photographers and to make bigger photographs in the magazine with this issue. And yes, that's the things with the architecture. But you asked, what do I think about architecture and photography? Well, that's quite a question. Huh? Mm-hmm. I mean, I started after my school, I wanted to be a photographer because I couldn't decide between photography and journalism. And journalism was paid very bad. So, and the photographers, they earned in these times in Germany, I started in Hamburg, they earned between 2,000 and 3,000 marks a day. It's quite a lot for someone who's 24. And so I decided to do architecture photography. And but I always change between these two versions because in these times the photographers went to the magazines and they had to leave their photos and then you can leave to get by. In all the magazines they did the stories. And the photographers had not so much to do with this. So for this reason, I tried to do a reportage with both writing and photography. That was a quite interesting time, and I think that's our former times. It's not, you can't do this today anymore, because it's too complicated, all this to do this both together. But in these times, to do a reportage was quite interesting, and what I wanted, I don't show the photos now, I didn't do it later. Right. So the difference, I would say, or I would do with the thesis, is that it has changed completely, that you have more possibilities to invent things and to develop your own, what I call, aesthetic Bildsprache. Huh? Sometimes I have to do it in German, the Bildsprache. And today I see more or less photos, architecture was, which are documents, the document house. And it's very interesting to see this. This is completely different. This is very expressive, and I think all the people try to do something different beyond the documentation of an architect. It has a lot to do with the development of the magazines and the architects, but I will stop here. So my wish is to stress more to the young photographers to dare something and to be expressive in their way, not to do photos that architects like.
I mean, you give like the I think the most important topic right now. So is architecture photography like something which has to document things, or is it like a question of interpretation of things? And we had the feeling the documentation is there. Kind of did not mention now that in this time you were the chief editor of Arctis, it was the rise of the internet, so the amount of images available kind of exploded. The other thing is also that the digital photography came into place, so also making a photo was getting cheaper and it was easier. So the amount of images at the time when you did the magazine was kind of exploding, and we were faced now with a situation where we know that all the images we normally shown in Arctis and Swiss performance are already online in the internet. So if you're interested, you just Google one of these projects and you have all the images there. So we wondered why publish them again and again, and it is the same set because the architects kind of assigned it, so you will see it over and over. So we just had the feeling it's a waste of paper. So that we actually then came also, like you said, to the clue that we actually have to see architecture photography as an act of interpretation, because otherwise we just run around in circles and waste time and money, and we're also getting bored in the editor's office. Also quite so maybe I give them the microphone to Quentin first, because you already kind of made like a connection to the exhibition and said it's quite interpretational. So I would like to ask you, and you of course can say something to that.
As you already said in the
nowadays I have the feeling that architectural photography is part of a logic of a realistic reproduction of a building. Let's say that is the last step of the architectural project itself. The final, in a way, the final testimony of a long process of work directed by the architect. So this objective relationship to the photographed building can be explained easily by the fact that by the relationship between the photographer and the architect. The architect becomes the client of the photographer. So in a sense, the photographer submits himself to his client to present his work in the best possible way, from his to present the building in his best angle, and showing the particularities put forward by the architect himself in his building. So if we can make an analogy with another field of photography, like fashion photography, it's like we could say that it's equivalent to making the lookbook of a collection of clothes or something like this. But as we know, for example, in fashion photography, there is also campaign or something like this, where a photographer is more free to interpret clothes and everything. So it became a combination between photographers and the creator, fashion designer or architect, or something like this. So the deal here was to try to avoid this kind of realistic documentation, and you can also photograph the building in a realistic way or more in an abstract way to reinforce the idea of the architect in the building. And so that was my starting point to make photography.
I have a question. Did you bring in the yellow green light?
Yeah.
Into the architecture.
Yeah.
And is it sort of like matching in the sketches? Because it's a very classical way to present a building still
yeah.
in a house.
Yeah.
Did you kind of duplicate the signaletics or the way of how the new parts in the building were? It's
the
yellow, and he's using this yellow color, yellow green color in the house.
Actually, you didn't see the plans, I think. We just got the plans from the architect, we realized that the colors were matching.
Okay.
Our graphic designer wanted to kind of make it black and white, and we just said, no, leave it, it's nice, it's yellow, and the picture has a yellow touch, so we just discovered it matches, but there's no concept behind it. I think when we see the drawings before we printed it, it makes those photos.
Yeah, I choose to use a tool like the laser. At the beginning, it was to reinforce a certain line that the architect, in this rehabilitation, that the architect made some cut in the wall. So my first idea was to use this red green light to reinforce those lines, those cuts in the building. And after making some pictures, the line was also this
idea to have a common thread through the pictures, to have finally a small autonomous universe between pictures.
I think we should keep the ball right with you, Maria, because for example, looking at the publication you did with The House is a House, and so on. We also had a look at this, and we realized that you actually tried to portray a house, not by documenting it with a wide angle lens, but with focusing on certain details and make a patchwork of details, not only of the house, but also the surrounding. So by kind of making a palimpsest of different photos coming together, being maybe not a documentary, but somehow a characterization of the project. You now have to answer if I'm ready or not.
Okay. Maybe it's interesting to talk about the book because it is a different type of architectural monograph. It's a monograph by Johnston Mark Lee, who were the curators of the Chicago Architecture Biennial this last year, 2017. Actually, I think none of these works have been commissioned in that sense. In my case, for instance, it is like a private kind of like relationship that Mark became a collector of my work in the 90s when he was in Zurich and I was working at Scalo, and he invited me to come over to Los Angeles and collaborate with them, and that was in 99, 2000, and I was like, okay, but you are kind of like having an architectural firm and I'm working as an artist, so how could we collaborate? I only knew these ways of collaboration between like Adrian Chies and Shigong Guyer, like on colors, or Herzog de Meuron and the photographers, but it was not about a building, it was about a way of thinking. So it took me 10 years to go there and just to visit Los Angeles and look at the buildings that it had been producing in during this time. And I'm also asking for like, what is your favorite kind of places? So I wanted to see Los Angeles through their eyes. And it became some sort of, as I'm a kind of snapshot photographer and I'm collecting material, and in the end, I might come up with some more conceptual ideas out of my archive. I was collecting, and I went there every year to see them, and they told me they were working together, collaborating with people like Jim Welling and many other super interesting artists. And this book is sort of like divided in five parts. It's five buildings. And every artist is in charge of one building, and I was given like the kind of like the opening of the book and the ending of the book.
It is
some sort of like my idea, like the material I collected over the years around this sort of like discussions and places that have a lot to do with the relationship I have with the architects.
So do I get you right when you say you wanted to portray a house, but at the same time you portray the architects, because you say you show places they like, and then you also show the surrounding of the house, but that is a personal reading, so actually there are like three layers in this documentation.
I don't want to portray anything. Like, this is part of my artistic practice, and in fact I see everything as some sort of like an object or a human being in a way with a soul. So it doesn't matter if I photograph a chair or a person or a mountain or my own body, there is this sort of relationship. It's a bit,
so it's a starting point actually.
That's my practice.
Where you find your own interest.
Yeah.
And maybe at the end you do not see much of the project anymore, because it's also important.
It was not about a project.
About starting at a place.
It's about the relationship. It's about a way of thinking. Like, I want to understand, why is Mark Lee interested or buying this work by mine? And then I see sort of like a relation or an idea represented in an architecture of his, and I recognize my kind of like ideas in them. I proposed him like, I don't know, exhibitions I want to do, I'm not sure. I proposed him like this book before it came out, and I said, can you please look through it? And it was at Kunsthaus Café, and it was a half an hour chat, and I got his feedback. So it's about exchanging ideas, and as they're very clever in dealing with space, and I'm clever in dealing with images, it's interesting to collaborate. But there was never the aim that I would represent a building or an architectural firm or Los Angeles as a context. It was more like, okay, this is what I got. Do you like it? And they say it has a lot to do with what we're doing. So we feel kind of like we see ourselves mirrored in your work. That so it's much looser.
Complexity. You try to read them in their project at the same time as you try to read yourself in the project. So it's like a very complex.
That's what I think. That's what artists do. It's sort of like setting up a thing that can be talked about in a way, without words also, with ideas, with new ideas, with other books, with other architects, with other photographers that come up and in that sense I would say it's more like a really an interdisciplinary kind of exchange of methods and of ideas.
I'd like to give this topic to the round. So should architecture and photography be like reading whatever kind of focus one might have, maybe asking what the intention of the architect might be, maybe what your own reading of it is, and is it like a thing which has like an authorship and a concept and to it, or is it more like a discovery, and is it maybe should it have less randomness, more like a discovery tour without really knowing what you're going for?
I think basically we have to pose the question when you talk about architecture photography, from which context are you talking about? Because you talked about basically, and also Christoph, about architecture photography being caught up in the economy of attention, image politics. Images are instrumentalized to represent certain ideas, certain perspectives. So, that are applied images, and you clearly say, I'm not in that context. And I think then those images are also read in a different way. So, and then it's also the questions, where are your images represented again? So, let's say, I would say there's no one type, one single kind of architecture photography. We have to differentiate that. And I even would question if there is something as architecture photography, but at the same time it's a very artificial category. Well, honestly, I can't, only under certain circumstances I can deal with this word. And otherwise I would much more talk about, let's say, interpretations, visual storytelling, and then, so to say, this category is not so present anymore.
But I mean, it's a genre, it's like portrait photography, so you speak within a specific kind of understanding what the image of a human person is.
There is a canon.
You have it in painting, you have it in all different media, so we...
I think we also were confronted sometimes with the question, is should we discuss about architecture photography at all? Because everything which is about photography kind of captures like three-dimensional spaces, and you can also then ask, is like fashion photography, like the commercial level of portrait, and now it's like this kind of architecture photography we're dealing with as a magazine and the home pages of the architects in general. This is a commercial version of some spatial photography. So of course you can question these terms, but it has, I think, a lot to do with who gives the direction, and if it's something you can have a free interpretation with as an artist, or do you have directions and you just fulfill something you should do, or is it like a commercial focus direction?
Well, let's say given the fact, Architese, let's say, aims to talk about or to have a discursive approach to architecture, then some will say those images could be read or are read or can be read as, let's say, discursive images. Of course, you also look to the formalities, you start to read them, etc. When I go to the website of an architecture office, this is public relations, depending a bit on, but most of the time it's just public relations. So the code is very clear on this, the purpose.
Are you asking for the topic of beginning? Like, I don't want to interrupt, but there is a really, I think, from Chicago, I came back with this really, because photography was intertwined with architecture, so there were like 11 photographical positions, part of the biennial, which was very interesting. And of course, they were dealing with buildings, and sometimes they were commissioned. And one topic that is especially brought up to discussion by the curator, Jesus Vazalo, who is a Spanish architect and writer based in Houston, Texas, at Rice University. And he, in his PhD thesis, he's writing about architecture kind of like abusing photography with the aim to kind of like clean the life out of the picture to represent this cultural, neutral, whatever, Polish beauty of the building. And he is thinking a lot about the documentary and architecture. And I think there is a lot of potential in allowing architecture to get old before it gets documented or photographed, to work with the life of a building, to work with the people that live in a building. But these are mine books. By Nuno Brandão Costa, who is a Portuguese architect representing Portugal for the biennial this year in Venice. And he made this publication, and a friend of mine, Andre Cepeda, a photographer, photographed all his buildings from the last 20 years. So you have these buildings look old and used sometimes, but he made just like pictures, great pictures, and the whole book, as the other book, is an entity in itself, so it's something very different from a magazine where you have an article, a writer, a text, some illustrations. It's like a whole concept of looking at something. And here you look at the work of Nuno, but it is like a visual journey, and it is like somebody's telling you constantly stories. And it's in different fields, different people, in different environments, different buildings. And occasionally you learn about the ideas of the architect. But this is a very, could be an appropriate way to get away from these design aspects of how architecture as a design product and then photography that represents the design and puts it in the center and adds interesting lights and asks for attention, but maybe to bring it back to a documentary level where the building as an existing object that also determines our lives is a raising as a backdrop somehow.
That's a topic. I think everybody who does magazines, all the architects would agree that they would actually like to see the architecture in use, mm-hmm. maybe like 5 or 10 or 20 mm-hmm. years after. The problem is, of course, that you have to photograph it before you give it to the people living there who rent it or buy it, because later it can get quite difficult to get in there. Even some of our architects already face these problems because mm-hmm. the apartments are rented, so it gets quite a hassle. So it's one on the one side that the architects might be able to control the aesthetics by kind of not having the users and the furniture and the patina of the building. On the other hand, some want it or many want it, but it's also really difficult. It's quite a big challenge. The effort gets bigger. And of course, also in the exhibition, we also want to, can we see it? Of course, we cannot, because these are like new projects. The question is, you could have shown, tried to show the users, you could have tried.
try to show the furniture in those places where it's in there. But interesting enough, you, I think most of the objects and the way they're portrayed here, you don't see it. So the question is also to the others, how important would it be, or what would it change the way architecture could be photographed, where we kind of put the focus on the user, on the way how it changes within time, or is it actually not interesting? Is it a totally different genre of photography?
Well, you posed as a question, I think yes. But maybe for the room here, the audience, I'm very interested in on one hand, let's say, photography as it once was, and where photography or photographic practices are going. And I would stretch that so far as our algorithmic vision. So photography as a form of representation that is related to what we see versus to what we know. Let me quickly explain. We all know satellite images that are no pictures, that are no photos. That is data. Data is transferred in readable images. For people, readable persons, readable images. We see on all levels that we expand our way of looking to the world with all kind of seeing machines. Trevor Paglen, artist, is looking at that, and which means that. Everything becomes documentable, visible, reproducible, etc. So that is, of course, very often, systematic, machine-based, etc. So I believe a lot that, as an opposition towards this development, the subjective, the interpretive aspect, and the narrative, even the artistic interpretations become more and more valuable, basically to counter, that is what is documented and represented in a machine-based way. So I think this subjective storytelling and is becoming more and more valid. I would say so.
But it needs a context.
Sorry?
It needs a context. It's not about single images.
No.
Like this one is more interested because it's free or something like this.
No, but that is, this storytelling, part of storytelling is this contextualization.
The context here is a magazine, and here is a book, and then it can be the website, and it can be the festival, so you always have to reestablish kind of a reading, right?
Yeah, well, for me, a festival and a magazine function in a, different way.
Of course.
Yeah, I would like to ask something similar that you can call that to Stefano. The question is as we have the internet and all the images are available all the time in a huge amount, the question comes, what do the other mediums do with the photo actually? So what do we do as a magazine? What do you do as a curator of an exhibition? How do you deal with photography there, especially spatial or architectural photography? So how do we have to react to that? And we should maybe talk about Professor Limage and the way you're presenting the images there, asking yourself what is the exhibition today in the internet age which deals with space?
Now, first of all, we never show architectural photography because it's very boring, as you said. And we don't like boring things, so we try to have fun and we try to use architecture a lot to show our photography. So it's really turning the things upside down. And actually, what we are really looking for is how an image can change a building and how a building can change the narrative of an image. So that's really an obsession. Oh yeah, that's Venate Busa, for example, on the on the Nestle building, Nestle Worldwide Headquarters building. And you know Renate Buser, she's from Basel and she works a lot with architecture. So we asked her to make a piece for us here. It's one of the largest pieces we made, 1,000 square meters, I think, a bit more. And she tried to play with the transparency of the building, which was one of the two main ideas when we built the building. And she took the pillar system of the ground floor, and she very little changed it with Photoshop, really changed it a little, and then could install it very large. But you see that the pillars are the same, are in the ground, and then actually people could really see through the building, the lake and France on the other side, the French mountains. So, for us, the interaction between photography and architecture is very important, also in an urbanistic discussion. So, how can a festival change the meaning of a building? How can photography change the meaning of a building, even more difficult, the meaning of a building for the people who grew up in the city, that see that building every day since they are kids, and they don't see it anymore. And suddenly, when you use photography in a certain way, people, first of all, see these buildings again, they rediscover their own city, and secondly, they kind of like rediscovered the history of the building, the meaning of the building. I don't know if you put it in the slideshow, we made a very nice installation with John Baldessari. You can look at it here, actually. It's this picture here, which you can now maybe client. It's a nice story because it's a very small picture of John Baldessari, which is, as you know, a very conceptual artist. And one of the most famous conceptual artists from America. And his picture is a very totally unknown picture from his catalogue Raisonné. I found it there. And it's called A Man Behind Vertical Lines. And it's one of thousands of conceptual works of John Baldessari. I asked him if I could take this picture and blow it up really large and put it on the ancient prison of the city. And he, 24 hours later, he accepted. He said, yes, please do it. And we tried with him, and we did a couple of exchanges. And then he was very happy with the solution we found. And what happened then was very interesting, because this conceptual picture, like man behind vertical lines, became actually something like man behind bars, man behind prison bars, and maybe as the guy is well-dressed, maybe some Zurich banker behind bars, who knows? But something totally narrative started to come out from that really conceptual story. Because of the building we choose, because of the location we choose, because of the way we set it up in the city. And this idea of setting up things is really important and brings me just to another topic that I would like to very shortly talk about, is this whole, it's boring, architectural photography, but it's really powerful. But it's powerful because the buildings are powerful. So you will not really, even if the program is fantastic, and I really think it's a great idea to do that, to bring it to the very creative level, where the photographers comes in without the architect. It's kind of a kind of banal story, because it's the moment where the architect and the photographer divorce, and the photographer says, okay, I don't need you anymore, I just need your building, I can get out. And the architect says, okay, I don't need you anymore, because I have my pictures of Thomas Hof, and I have all the good pictures to make my PR. So it's actually pretty common. And that's what I wanted to say. Jesus Christ. Set-up photography, yes. What I found really interesting, actually, with the old architecture issue is the whole thing that happens from the 70s, 80s, which is the really set-up photography like Miriam Beckström, like James Casbier, like Thomas Zimmern, that actually they become architects themselves. And they build up their own things, and then they bring you in something that you really aren't into trouble to understand if you're in architecture photography, if you're in art, if you're in photography. This 2D, 3D game where they should be paid for to bring 3D into 2D. And they said, okay, let's start to do 3D ourselves. And then you have this huge setup of Thomas de Man, and he shoots them again, and then something really happens. But they don't need the architects. They have to be creative themselves. And as long as you do architectural photography, you work for someone and you have to make his building beautiful. And he made a beautiful building, so it's easy for you to make good pictures. We all are good photographers when we have a good building. Like the glass houses, anybody can go to the glass house here and there, and all the pictures will be great because the architecture is good. So it's like when you do pop photography, like stage photography. When I was 20, I was for the Montreux Jazz Festival shooting in the Montreux Jazz Festival, and I showed my pictures, and everybody was like, wow, great pictures. I was, no, it's just James Brown, the picture, but Miles Davis, but the picture is really shit. So the subject is good. So the same with architecture photography. The subjects are now so good, so photogenic, because they are built to be photogenic, that anybody can do architecture photography.
You mentioned now that there actually could be, or some artists already do it, take like the architecture like a canvas and put their own thing and their own artwork on it. And I think we should then ask Quentin again about his project of the transformation of the one family house, because actually there's a kind of mix. There's this reading of the original object, there's a reading of the transformation, but I think there's also the approach to bring in like another level, so it's like adding something to the architecture actually.
There is something that when I don't choose the building, so I came in there with a very powerful tool that was the laser, so that can twist every space quite easily. So my practice at the beginning is more an art practice. So in this practice, I'm trying to formulate some abstract science facts like black hole and something like that. So I really used to create picture from the real, but twisted. I'm really used to twisted reality. So when I came in this building, I was a bit in between two thoughts. I mean, respect the idea of the architect in this building, because we have met before I made the pictures, and I also want to bring spaces in another maybe a level or imaginary world. So.
Yeah, but you could bring your laser in any building, and then you make something out of it.
Yeah.
So that's why it's not architecture photography anymore. It's like you can take a portrait and play it with a laser on the face of the person, and then you get some Picasso style portrait. So it's not about the portrait or the architect, it's like you taking the material you want. It's a person, it's a cat, it's a building, and doing something out of it. So that's more. So we are leaving the real architecture photography thing to get into some art approach, which is very important in your topic, in your way to try to find out what could be the next level for architectural photography.
So I wanted to continue to say the architecture is good and the photography is good. Und ich sage das jetzt mal auf Deutsch, das geht einfacher. Es geht ja darum, eigentlich, dass, wenn ich einen Artikel über Kunst lese, kommt immer nach 3 Minuten das Wort ikonisch heutzutage. Und ich finde es interessant, wenn man von Ikonografie spricht. Es gibt eben Häuser, die eigentlich durch die Fotografie erst eine gewisse Bedeutung erlangt haben. Und man muss das nicht vergessen, Architekturfotografie verfälscht immer, manipuliert immer und interpretiert immer. Das geht gar nicht. Diese Ecke hier ist eine Architekturfotografie-Ikone, die in jedem Architekturhandbuch zu finden ist. Es ist, aber diese Ecke gibt es gar nicht in dem Gebäude in der Form. Das Es ist das Chilehaus in Hamburg und es steht eigentlich symptomatisch für Backsteinexpressionismus. Wenn du ein Foto weitermachst, dann sieht man, dass das der gesamte Komplex ist und dass dies hier die Ecke ist, die überhaupt nicht auffällt. Das heißt, ja, diese Ecke ist durch Architekturfotografie erst zu einer Bildikone geworden. Das ist ja nicht schlecht. Die Frage ist, ob das ist, eigentlich stellt sich gar nicht, ob das gut oder schlecht ist. Aber wir haben alle gelernt, dass das der norddeutsche Backsteinexpressionismus ist, obwohl er das in der Form eigentlich überhaupt nicht ist. Machen wir mal das nächste. Und das ist das eigentlich mein Appell, dass man an die Architekturfotografen so etwas zu riskieren, das vermisse ich heute mehr in der Architekturfotografie. Dieses etwas verpinselt. Nehmen wir mal das nächste. Das ist auch so einer. Das ist der Fotograf Reinhard Wolf gewesen. Der hat sich eine eigene Kamera gebaut und hat die New Yorker Wolkenkratzer von oben fotografiert. Machen wir mal das zurück. Schade, dass das so groß nicht kommt. Und dadurch haben wir eigentlich eine völlig neue Sehweise auf diese Details der amerikanischen Wolkenkratzer. Ich weiß nicht, ob Sie sich daran erinnern, aber das war, ist überall publiziert worden. Diese ganzen Apikot-Geschichten und so, die hat man eigentlich durch die Fotografie erst entdeckt. Und das ist eigentlich für mich die Aufgabe von Architekturfotografie, dass ich durch eine gewisse Sehweise oder durch einen gewissen Ausschnitt, wie auch immer, das bleibt dem Fotografen überlassen, dass ich eigentlich dadurch erst die Bildbedeutung, um die es ja eigentlich geht, die weit über die Dokumentation hinausgeht, die eigentlich dadurch erzeugt wird. Machen wir das nächste. Oder kannst du, ey, lass mal so durch, ja, das machen wir weiter. Er hat das dann auch mit den spanischen Kastellen gemacht und hat das auch gut, aber das ist nicht gut, weil das so schlecht kommt. Das kann man, wir müssen auch gar nicht mehr weiter sagen, das kann man weiter fortführen. Es gab die Lichtarchitektur in den 20er Jahren, die entdeckt wurde, oder machen wir noch eins weiter, wo du eigentlich auch durch die Fotografie erst überhaupt diese Sehweise von Architektur entstanden ist. Und das ist eigentlich das, darüber will ich gerne mal sprechen, wie können wir das hinkriegen, was ich the relationship between architecture and photography, which is in my opinion very
important. But actually then kind of plea for a zoom in or for a different view that brings something into the view which is already kind of inherent in the architecture. So when you see these experiments like from Quentin, where he actually added a new layer with kind of spaces. This is still something which you think is an interesting approach for architecture, or is it already too much?
No, I think it's a quite interesting way. It's exactly the way of expression we need today to go away from all this documentation, this clear photography, which you said. In my view,
I would tap into that I think that. This so-called architecture photography, as you described, is much more a kind of prototyping. The prototyping of ideas, the prototyping of Sehweisen, different angles of how you, or conceptual views on our built environment.
Yes.
And I also agree with this your example that this idea that it's not only about making photographs or visualizations of, let's say, the existing, but also, I think, the imagination and the interpretation, also into, let's say, constructed images or even rendering, etc., as part of that prototyping. I think, first of all, we have the technologies anyway. Let's use them in an interesting way. And yeah, I would subscribe to this idea of developing or using this possibility much more to create, let's say, subjective prototyping. And then, of course, integrate it not as a, let's say, as an isolated art form or, art form is one part, but also as a, let's say, discursive part. I even would suggest to bring that back in architecture discourse. Mm-hmm. Let's say part of architectural schools, for instance. Because then you start dialogue between disciplines.
One thing I wonder about is then as soon as we do the zoom in, we might see some ideas or concepts or aspects of the building more clearly, like you showed with the example of the Art Deco buildings. But there's one big critique about architecture and photography in these days that it kind of blends out the context and therefore kind of pushes like an aesthetization, or maybe like that make every building look very conceptual and not totally neglecting the questions of where it is and how it interacts with its surrounding. And I think you can also ask exactly that questions when looking at the work of the eight photographers here, that the context is almost never shown. It's more an approach of zooming in and by strengthening certain aspects and meaning of the building, but most of them bled out the context. I mean, there could also be a point where the photographers, which are the audience, might tune in and kind of play the role now around further. So the question of the context and the lack of context, which is kind of obvious in many of the assigned photographers, but also in these photos which happen with in God, which is interesting to me.
Well, what do you mean by context? Is it the surrounding?
The surrounding, actually. Yeah.
That you don't see the outside of the building.
Exactly. Yeah.
So there's no way to look at the outside if you focus on the inside.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But you could also maybe do like photographers only out of the view, you don't show the objects, you just show the views, for example. You could do that.
Mm-hmm.
The question is why does it not happen? So there is a big plea. All the colleagues in this course I know from academia is always about context. And it's also something we have been discussing with the architecture media now for decades. The questions it was raised by the minimalist discussion from the 90s, where the objects were kind of attacked for being introverted and only looking at themselves. So the questions came, well, how does Swiss architecture deal with the context? And the question is still there. And I also wondered if maybe photographers would try to answer these questions or to bring up a critique by showing it. So that is something I
so confusing. I'm sorry. Like minimalism as an art form is out of context. The object or the measurements stand for themselves.
Correct. And that is the critique which was then also kind of formulated against minimalist architecture.
I think we talk on so many levels with different words or the same words, but they mean something different. Maybe you want to give
the question.
I mean, there is a view, there is a context in this case, and this person is here.
I think what's really important as well when you're in a space is to just feel what's around you and the details you're focused on. And I don't feel like when I enter an architecture, at first I get a feeling, I don't like see the architecture in its whole, or I'm not focused on the review, or I'm just gonna be like, okay, I enter this place. For example, the one on the cover, I haven't seen it in real, but I could totally imagine you look up and you have this sensation, which is really powerful, and you kind of, even without seeing the building, you feel it with the picture. And I guess that when you enter a space, you get immediately focused by things that attract your attention and that were like really well crafted, really well put together in thought, and also the measurements, the it's like good design, you know, it's like why is design good or bad? Like, I know it's discussable, but it's also because of shapes, because of details, of forms, and of how it reacts to light. And I think the reason why I guess many photographers put their point of view on something specific is because these things are so important. And when you see an architecture in its whole, you don't see necessarily these small details in the ceiling or in a small angle, or how even the interrupter and like the light switches, like that's something you don't, like nobody really notices, but it's so important. Like there are such ugly and such great light switches, for example, in architecture, and it's something that's so important, I guess, like all these tiny details. what makes a building actually a great building to live in or to work in or to be in. So I guess if nobody puts that point of view or also acknowledge that these importances, who would do it?
I don't want to be misunderstood. I didn't say that the zoom in is not a logical approach. I just asked, could the other view, big view, the object in its surrounding, where we see architecture not only as something which creates space, but which also like an object in a city or in a landscape, this is not interesting to anyone of you?
Well, I was wondering if you talk about context only about, let's say, physical environment, because context is, use context, there are many aspects, let's say, the organizational context, the ecological, economic context, etc. So if you, as a photographer or image maker, storyteller, artist, can, let's say, include that as context as well, and then, of course, the environmental is also one aspect. But so to say, then it becomes rich. Then you start to all kind of establish all kind of relationships, and then it becomes also, if you do it well, specific.
But you're asking really about the future of architectural photography, right? And there is no future for architecture. There is no future. It's just like what the architect wants. It's on one side, and the creativity of the artist on the other side. So there is no other future than the creativity of the artist in the way they reuse the architectural proposal to make something of themselves. But the needs of a magazine, the needs of an architectural agency, the needs of promotion, we always go from the light switch to the environment, to the concrete they use, to the facade, and so on. Then it's so there is no other future than that boring future of reproducing and documenting the architectural product. There is no future. Nothing funny. The only thing funny is what we see here. Is what when the artists come in, doesn't care about the assignment, doesn't care about what the architects wanted to say. All the photographers said, "Yeah, I want to know what the architect wanted to say." That's not true. They want to use the building to tell something else. And when the narrative comes in, when the photographer brings an added value to the building, which is his added value. What he brings is his own story. And if you happen to be in Berlin in the next weeks, go to see the Onorato and Krebs exhibition. Tai Onorato and Nico Krebs have a very nice exhibition in the Kindle. And they have this fantastic architectural photography with this, you know them probably, with this wooden structures in the front, and then in the back of the building, and the wooden structure takes all the lines, the strong lines of the buildings again, but you are 100 meters away, and that's just fantastic. But we don't care about the architect and everything. We just have this architecture reused through some narrative, creative idea, and suddenly the photographer tells me much more. He brings me another story. He tells me something more than the architect with this building. That's the only future.
It seemed that, we are talking about photography, but what about the architects? How did they react to all these projects? Do they don't care? I don't know, maybe you can a little bit say what were, because it was a carte blanche to the photographers, and were all the architects happy with the project? Did you have some restriction? You had to stop a project? It seems not, so maybe you can explain this.
That's an interesting question. First of all, you mentioned something which is very depressing. So the feedback culture of the things we do is very, very small. So there's almost nobody writing me or calling me and answering or giving me like a feedback to a text. And it's the same about the photos. It's we are very much used that media is like a one-way thing. Though we have like social media today, there might be is an interaction, but this kind of media is still scarily enough considered like a one-way thing, which somebody is sending and the others do accept it. There was one case which was interesting, it was with Quentin's work, because he took the freedom at one picture to kind of retouch the space. It was the architects
took away one floor, so they made one space like a double height space, which was like, which is now like the center of this house, which is a double story dining room, and it has some kind of interesting or strange looking black hole openings in the upper floor. And Quentin just took the freedom to kind of make out of two windows, three actually, right? He moved it, so he sort of put another one on this empty wall too. And the architects called me, so they were upset because it was the only picture in the series which was not just added the laser, but it was like changing, like, and you couldn't really tell it. And if you didn't know it, you wouldn't have guessed that this was manipulated. And they were upset about that because they suddenly had the feeling this is now too much, because it's not just the green light in it. Suddenly he kind of changes the architecture. And they in the recording, I don't know, about two times, I think we had them maybe even more times on the phone about that. So that was in Border, which was kind of touched, where the architects start to feel inconvenient with it.
But you were not surprised, were you?
Actually, I did not even realize that the thing was manipulated. Because anyhow, we saw the secret photos, so we put it in there. We read the plans, but we didn't read them that closely to realize that, because it was done so nicely.
Then maybe you will add something to that anecdote.
When I've done this manipulation or retouch, I already know that the architects would be a bit, let's say, because this picture was showing the main space of the house, which was the big argument of the architect. So yeah. But in a way, but these images, well, I really like it like this, in fact, because it twisted the architecture in a way that could be useful for the whole series of images.
I think that's actually a freedom we would have appreciated, so we would encourage that. We were more like surprised that some were very, very respectful to the architects. Which I remember now, as you're asking another story about the Runas pictures, also the other days, these are the ones which are right next to us, these details of the walls and corners, that the architects, they were just concerned that this might be the only images of the building in the magazine, and they were afraid, because it's a nice building, that people wouldn't really get it, and that these details don't represent this kind of complex and manifold ideas which are in the project. And that was the only, we also, there at this point, we also did not know if that's enough. And you could see that's the only exception in the whole magazine where we added, I don't know, dare to call it the standard set of photographs which were kind of commissioned by the architects, because we also, we love these pictures, but we also had a feeling you might not get the impression that you won't understand a lot of the things which is then discussed in the essay. So we just decided to put these next to each other, but with the standard set of photographs like in the second row. So yeah, maybe we make a last round. You know, it's a kind of plea for the future of architectural photography, telling that or saying that it should actually not be architectural photography anymore, because otherwise it's boring and has no future. Maybe we do like a final round asking what the future could be, and when the round comes to Christoph, I would be especially interested because you know all the economic kind of frameworks were at work and kind of broke out with this exhibition of this framework, but also with the financial help of Poelvizia, because otherwise this would not have been possible. I would like to ask how could this genre free itself from the constraints, what would be the future, and how could it be more like an authorship discipline than something which is only about being commissioned and directed by the architects? So,
I
point that architecture, good architecture, is inspiring. It's inspiring for people living it, it's inspiring for people shooting at it, photographing it. So the next level is really just how inspiring it is for an artist and what the artist tells, which added value he can bring in his picture. But I'm really impressed with your story because you're writing pretty documentary way about this house. So it's kind of obvious that the architect doesn't really want his windows changed. For me, it's kind of obvious. If you ask artists to come really in an inspiring way, to be really creative and to turn the whole thing upside down, and then you ask to a writer to write about this architecture, and then it becomes something like a really essay about an utopical way of telling about architecture, then it's okay. But if you put the documentary approach in the text, and then you just take windows away from the picture, something is kind of weird.
I have to react to this. So the question again is somebody like answering to the work of the other, or are both like authors and they're both free? And we tend to do the second. So actually also the authors of the text, we don't give them a briefing what to do, how to describe it, or if it has to be a description at all. They can do whatever they want. Also the text actually carte blanche. And we kind of take the freedom that the images have their own story, if somebody wants to tell a story, and the same with the text. In the ideal case, also the texts have their own story, which maybe moves away from just describing the things. But this is also something which might happen if the author takes the freedom, then we're happy to kind of promote this. But if he does not, if he sticks to a more documentary way of describing it, then is that what happens. But we totally don't want to do is like tell the photographer what the writer, what the author is doing, or tell the author what the photographer is doing. So sometimes the authors would ask us for the set of images and we would not give it to him because we didn't actually not want this kind of intertwining. So these are like two positions, they're separate. There might be dialogue, but there might be totally different stories too.
I think as you said, if we talk about architecture photography as an art, if photographer is an artist, it's a different story. If you work for a museum like Wandering, like Gotsky or other people, it's quite interesting, but it's another story. If you see architecture as a craftsmanship, it's quite different. And my hope, as you ask as a last round, my hope is that the architects should trust into the photography. So if they build a house, they should give it away, like a baby which is grown up. Huh? They must give it away to a photographer and trust the photographer that he will do a good job. Today it's the other way around. The architect says, I just want this photographer interpreting my house, otherwise you don't have to come to my house. I will not give it to you. That's the reality. Yeah? Am I right or not?
Yeah, sure. I mean, of course we have to do some, for some of these works, we have to do a lot of phone calls to get the permission to do this experiment, because it's a moment where we challenge this moment of total control.
It's a total control. It has changed completely to former times, and I'm hopeful that it will change again, that the architects will be selfish in give their work to whatever. The funny thing is, the more famous an architect is, like Herzog Dömerow, he was, in former times, he controlled everything. Now he's world famous, and he says it's okay, you can do what you want.
Actually right about that. Huh? When we started the series, we were sure that Herzog Dönerholm would not agree to that. Mm-hmm. And they were the easiest one and they had the biggest fun. The PR ladies, they called us and told us several times how great this work was, how much they liked it. So it was exactly the opposite of what we expected. And it's more than the young offices, which you think are a little bit more experimental, they just fresh from university. They are the biggest control freaks you can imagine.
So that's the architects can trust the journalists and the photographers. We can do it with the work.
I think there are, let's say, three parallel scenarios, or let's say three forms of what you could call maybe then architectural photography or image practices that deal with, let's say, the architecture or building art. So one, first of all, let's say the instrumentalized image, that is, let's say, the strategic image, the image that is used for strategic means. That is, let's say, also what you're pointing on. This will always be there. It will even increase. It will be, more fine-tuned. This is, of course, connected to, let's say, all the possibilities that you have today with media, with contemporary media technologies. That is, let's say, the practice of let's say, marketing and related fields. So this, let's say, the architects will work with this kind of, let's say, commissions, but also with this interest. And I think that even magazines, or even like Architects, is part of that system. So that is that. Then you have, let's say, we will see an increase in, let's say, imaging technologies. Let's say this idea that I brought up with seeing machines. Let's say the way we visualize our lives, our environments, from, let's say, photography, photographic means, virtual reality, augmented reality, and then also the application of that. I think that, let's say, this technical approach of visualizing, of course, partially also instrumentalized, let's say, by strategic means. And then, of course, this, let's say, much more subjective storytelling, maybe kind of, let's say, design criticism or architecture criticism through not only writing, but also through image making, and that, let's say, can have many forms, and from even still very kind of applied criticism, or let's say applied form, which turns out, or which functions as, let's say, architecture criticism, to, let's say, subjective artistic interpretations as far as, let's say, dreaming. And I think those, let's say, this marketing, machine image, machine-based looking versus this very subjective, discursive, but also subjective imagination of architecture. So that's my take on it.
I think we should finish now.
So thanks very much to you five experts. I'm pretty optimistic. I'm not that pessimistic as Stefano, but I think it's right. We have, like Christoph said, we have to kind of encourage also the architects, because they commission a lot of these works, to actually dare something, to let go, to let things happen. So they're not only these very small slots where we actually able to get a grant, to have the voluntary work of students or apprentices, so that actually it can also kind of be like an encouragement to kind of swap over to the professional system. So we will try to do our best to promote this kind of experiment as something which is valuable and fruitful. So thank you very much to the five of you again, and to, of course, again to the eight photographers. Seven others which have contributed this great work to this exhibition and also to the magazine. I invite you all now to stay. We have lots of drinks and we have even more sandwiches in the front room. So drink and eat. We will take out the chairs so that you have a good opportunity to look at the works here at this space. And if you like, come back next week, exactly 1 week after, on Thursday, for the Swiss Live performance, when then another 10 architects whose projects were not shown here, but have also done great buildings last year, will present their projects. We'll be happy to see some of you again. So I have a great evening. Thank you.